Come if your heart is searching. Oh, come if your soul is thirsty.
Turn with me to your Bibles in the book of Mark, chapter 12, reading verses 28 to 30. Mark chapter 12, reading from verse 28 to 30. Let me read from the New King James Version. Then one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together, perceiving that he had answered them well, asked him, "Which is the first commandment of all?" Jesus answered him, "The first of all the commandments is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. And the second like it is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than this.' So the scribe said to him, 'Well said, teacher, you have spoken the truth, for there is one God, and there is no other but he, and to love him with all the heart, with all the understanding, with all the soul, and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself is more than all the whole burnt offerings and sacrifices.' Now, when Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, 'You are not far from the kingdom of God.'" Father, we thank you so much for your word. Your word is life. And we want to pray, dear Lord, that as we look into this word today, Father, I pray that you will open our hearts. Help us, Lord, to comprehend this word. For your word tells us that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And I want to pray that you will help us, King of all glory, to be able to take this word in and be able to live according to its instructions. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. I want to build from where I started last Sunday. The Bible tells us that we need to love God with all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our strength, and to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And I said last Sunday that if you have not encountered Jesus, you may not be in a position to love him the way that he desires to be loved. But anybody that encounters Jesus, if you have seen him, you have heard him, you have accepted him, you have made him the Lord of your life, then I believe you will be able to love the Lord with all of your heart, with all of your mind, with all of your strength. And I gave you the illustration of the dog that saw the rabbit. And when he was chasing, other dogs joined in. But this dog that saw the rabbit did not give up when the others gave up. Why? Because he saw the rabbit. But those who did not see the rabbit gave up after a while. But I want to assume today that you have had an encounter with the Lord. And I want to assume that it is your desire that you may love God with all of your heart, with all of your mind, and with all of your strength. And I want to remind us that when this man, the scribe, came to Jesus to talk to him about, you know, the first commandment and the answer that Jesus gave to him, this answer was addressing the issue of passion. It was addressing how we need to do the things of God passionately, how we need to love God passionately, how we need to serve him passionately, how we need to live for him passionately. God desires that whatever we do for him, we do it with passion. And in Colossians chapter 3 and verse number 20, the Bible says, "Whatever you do, do it all, do it with all of your heart as unto the Lord." Whatever you do, do it with all your heart as unto the Lord. So in other words, God desires and God wants that we may love him with passion, serve him with passion, come to him with passion. Praise the name of the Lord. So maybe the question we need to ask is, what is passion? And somebody said passion can be described as the creative force behind all great art, the force behind all great drama, the force behind all great music, the force behind all great architecture, the force behind all great writing is passion. Anything that you can consider great, there was a passion that was driving the person or the people that did whatever it is that he did that you consider great. Because nothing great can happen without our people having passion to accomplish whatever it is. Passion is what energizes life. Passion gives somebody a reason to wake up in the morning and keep waking up to go and do something, you know, that they love, that they like. It is passion that makes scientists sit in a room, you know, months after months and years after years, trying to get a cure for a particular disease or a solution for a particular problem. It is passion that makes the people that want to discover stuff to continue looking for things, you know, year after year. And some of them take 10 years. I was listening to some documentary that they have discovered, you know, they have discovered where, this town now gets out of my mind. They have discovered where the place that God raised down, Sodom, where Sodom is, after 10 years of, you know, studying and looking at things. And can you imagine somebody doing that for 10 years? Yani, you are eating, you wake up just to go and read and research, and for 10 years. What is the driving force? The driving force is passion. Now, I want you to know that God created you with passion. That is why you have feelings. That is why you can love. That is why you can do the things you do, because you are created and wired with passion. Passion mobilizes armies to action. They are there moving on and continuing to do what they do because there's a driving force called passion. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, the world's view of passion is what you should never get into. Because the world wants us to believe that it is okay to be passionate for anything else, but not God. The world wants us to believe that it is okay to be passionate about football and not the things of God. And that is why it is okay for somebody to cry in a stadium, a big man crying in a stadium because their team has lost, and it is okay. But when a man cries in church, something doesn't seem to be fine. Why? Because the world wants us to believe that it is okay when it comes to the things of the world. The world wants us to believe that it is okay, you know, for you to be passionate about food. But it is not okay to be passionate about the things of God. The world wants us to believe that it is passionate to dance somewhere else, to anything else, to any other tune, but not to God. And that is why sometimes we feel uncomfortable when some people are dancing in the house of the Lord, because the world has made us to believe that it is not okay. It is fine to be passionate to do mugithi in a wedding. Hello, ladies. That it is okay for women, hallelujah, some of them big, some of them small, some of them short, some of them tall. It is okay for them to say, to the nambere, hanini, 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 eh? Tushoke bere ama tushoke nyuma. And it is fine to do that. But it is not okay to do it in the house of the Lord. This is what the world tells us about passion. But I'm here to remind us today, if there is anybody that we need to be passionate about, if there's anything we need to be passionate about, it is God and the kingdom of God. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. If it is fine for people to say twende mbere hanini and to shoke nyuma hanini, then I believe it is more appropriate to lift up my hands and sing to God, because he has a heaven I'm going to. He has a place I'm desiring to be. Wedding will take me nowhere. Hallelujah. But I'm here to tell you, Jesus is taking me places. And I need to love him with all of my heart, with all of my strength, and with everything within me. Praise the name of the Lord. God urges us that we may love him. Hallelujah. In Romans chapter 12 and verse number 1, Paul is saying, I beseech you, brethren. In other words, Paul is saying, people of God, if there is anything that we need to really give ourselves fully and wholly to, it is the service of this God. He says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, as alive as you are. Present this body to God fully, totally, without any reservation. Paul is saying, you know, when it comes to passion, it does not come automatically. This body has a way of rejecting the right things because it is a flesh that is fallen, and therefore I need to make a decision. I need to make up my mind that when it comes to God, I am going to fully surrender. I'm going to fully give myself to the Lord so that I can be able to worship him with zeal, to worship him with favor, to worship him with all passion. Hallelujah. It is something that I have to discipline myself to do. And this morning I want to encourage us, and I want to urge us, that we need to just speak to ourselves when we are coming to church, and you need to have a good talk with yourself when you are dressing up in that mirror and say, self, we are going to dance today. Self, we are going to worship the Lord today. Self, we are going to just love God today. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. It is not automatic that you will come to church and feel it's okay to do these things. Like I've said, because of the mentality that the world has tried to put into us, it is okay. You won't even struggle to wake up to go and sing mudhik, to dance mudhik in a wedding. But it is going to take you a lot of energy, a lot of determination, a lot of soul search to rise up and join Amani Komora in front here. It will take you a lot of, do I go, don't I go? How does it feel? You know, something within you is saying, go, but no. Not here, not today, not now. But when it is harusi, hey! Nobody opposes. I mean, everything within you just wants to do it. So what I'm trying to say is, we need to just discipline ourselves and say, when I'm going to the house of the Lord, church, self, we are going to worship. Hallelujah. We are going to dance. Praise the name of the Lord. I want to give us several passion killers that we need to be aware about. Things that if you are not careful, you will give your life to Jesus with all the joy, with all the excitement, but then all of a sudden, you will begin to just get cold. And if you're going to be aware of these passion killers, you are going to save yourself a lot of trouble. Hallelujah. And passion killer number one is an unbalanced life, or an unbalanced schedule of life. If your life is not balanced, if the schedule of your life is not balanced, your passion will begin to die. And this morning, the message I'm speaking to you is, please, don't let your passion die. I beseech you by the mercies of God, don't let your passion to die. Don't let an unbalanced schedule to kill your passion. Life is a series of seasons. Life is, everything to life is a rhythm. And therefore, you need to make sure that your life is balanced. God does not want people that will just come and sit in church and not work and do nothing. God expects us to work. God expects us to make money. God expects us to enjoy this life here. But God also expects that we are able to worship Him. We are able to serve Him. We are able to come together with the rest of the brethren and serve the Lord. And therefore, there must be a rhythm to your life. You know, not unbalanced, but your life ought to be balanced. If your job takes much more of your time than your God, there's a problem, and your passion for God is going to die. But don't let it die. Praise the name of the Lord. When you'd rather make money than be in the presence of the Lord, who gives you the strength and the wisdom and the life to go to that job, your life is not balanced. And that unbalanced lifestyle kills your passion for God. You need to be very careful about that. Life is not all about making money. Life is not all about attaining degrees. Life is not all about positions. Life is not all about achievements of this world. Life is about loving God, living for God, serving God. Hallelujah. And then all these other things, now you connect them to that. But you see, we have changed things around, and we think that life is all about achievement. Life is all about attaining stuff. Life is all about getting higher. But I'm here to remind us today, life is about God, who has given it to us. And we must be in a position to balance our life. Psalm 127 and verse number 2, the Bible says, from the Amplified Version, "It's senseless for you to work so hard from early morning until late at night, hey, fearing that you are going to starve to death. For God wants His loved ones to get their proper rest. Did you know that when you overwork yourself from Monday to Saturday and you give God 2 hours on a Sunday morning, you even sleep in the sermon? Why? Because your life is so unbalanced. Monday comes and you are running. You are running on Tuesday, you're running on Wednesday, you're running on Thursday, Friday, Saturday. The only time you sit is when you are this hour in church. And that is why you sit there, and all of a sudden life is not about attaining stuff. Be careful about the passion killer called an unbalanced schedule. Number two, passion killer, worries and cares of this world. The worries and the cares of this world, if you are not careful, they will kill your passion for God. It is not possible, people of God, it is not possible to worry and love God at the same time. It is not possible to be anxious about stuff and still be able to worship God freely. They just cannot mix. When you worry and you're anxious, all your mind is taken up with the worry and the anxiety. God has to give way. But if your heart and your mind is full of God, then worry and anxiety also have to give way. Therefore, be careful about the worries and the cares of this world. Matthew chapter 6 and verse number 33, the Bible tells us, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." Seek the kingdom of God. Seek the righteousness of the kingdom. These other things shall be added. You know, it's not about Seeking stuff is about seeking God. But when I'm so worried about, you know, there's a deal I'm going to make, and my mind is so much in the deal that I'm supposed to be making. You are in church, but you are scheming for the deal. You are in church, and you are thinking about the business, whatever. You are in church, but you are thinking of the work that you're supposed to be doing. When worries and fears and anxieties of life take hold of your mind, of your heart, there is no way you're going to love God with all of your soul and mind and heart and strength. Hallelujah. So we need to be careful about the worries of life and the cares of this world that try to take over the position of God, trying to overwhelm us with the, you know, with issues of life. And there we are, so overwhelmed by fears and worries and anxieties. In the book of James, we are even told, who has ever added a day by worrying? Who has ever done a miracle because they worried so much? Can you worry yourself to a promotion? Can you worry yourself to a marriage? Can you worry yourself to them, you know, blossoming of your business? You are so worried until business just decides, hey, this man is so worried, let's just, things become easy. It doesn't work like that. Worry, anxiety just makes things worse. Hallelujah. But when you are surrendered to God and everything about you, you have issues here, you are thinking about them, but it won't take long before you shift back to God and that the fact that he's able, the fact that he makes a way where there seems to be no way, a time will come because of that faith and that passion of God that things will have to give way for you to have a breakthrough. Hallelujah. Passion killer number three is doubt. When we doubt God's word, you know, God spoke to you. God impressed in your spirit and in your heart that things are going to work out for you. But now months have come, have passed, and years have passed, and you begin to doubt, did I hear God clearly? Am I really in the will of God? The moment you begin to doubt the word of God, that is the time your passion for the things of God begin to die. That is why when people hear God, they're so excited, they are ready to give themselves to the service of the Lord. But when now they begin to encounter challenges, they begin to encounter issues in life, they begin to wonder, am I in the will of God? And the moment you begin to doubt that you are in the will of God, your passion for God dies. And the same thing happens even in marriage. When you get married, you are so excited, you are in this wedding, everything is so good, you know, you may kiss the bride and you are there, you know, you are happy kissing the bride, and then life begins. And when life begins and you begin to realize, I begin to wonder, is this the same woman I married? Is this the same man I married? How come now she looks different? How come now she's not as I thought? Am I in the will of God? Am I in the right marriage? The moment you begin to question that, your passion dies even for that marriage. The same way when we doubt the word of God, we can never be passionate when we are doubting. Hallelujah. And in Psalm 119 and verse 89, the Bible tells us that the Lord's word is forever settled in heaven. Hallelujah. Come rain, come sunshine, whether the devil dances or cries, the word of the Lord is settled in heaven. Praise the name of the Lord. God speaks it and God settles it. But the problem is, because of, you know, the duration of the fulfillment, many times we begin to worry. I'm imagining Abraham. God has just promised him that he's going to have a son, and he's so excited. He's even leaving his home and his people because of the word of God. He's out, you know. God is going to do some stuff. And then years pass by, and they begin to doubt, especially from the woman. The woman begins to doubt, and the woman convinces Abraham that maybe it will not work out the way God had planned it. Maybe that is not what God meant. And the moment that doubt came in, the passion that Abraham had just dwindles. I pray that we'll be careful about the passion killer called doubt. Passion killer number four is a dormant talent, an unused gift that God has given to you. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter number 4 and verse 10, each of you has been blessed with a gift. Hallelujah. A wonderful gift. And this gift is supposed to be used for the body. It says, as each one has received a gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. God has given you a gift and a talent not to sit on, not to admire, but for you to minister, to use it, to encourage, build, bless, touch somebody else's life with your gift. When it is not properly utilized, passion dies. But when you are using your gift, you are passionate, you are excited. Actually, you actually flow. Hallelujah. That is why somebody that is gifted in as a singer, you know, you have the voice and you have what it takes. When they sing, they don't have to struggle with anything. They are just flowing and they enjoy it. Praise the name of the Lord. But when they sit on it, even the passion, the excitement to sing is not there. But the moment they begin to utilize it, you see life coming in. Why? Because unused gift kills passion. But when talents and gifts are used, hallelujah, then people come to life. And that is why Paul tells Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse number 6, therefore, I remind you to stir up the gift that is in you by the laying on of my hands. Hallelujah. And many of us this morning, we need to start up the gift in us, because don't sit there and think, oh, me, I have no gift. Everyone has a gift. And the gift must be stirred up. Hallelujah. So that you can be able to be passionate for the things of God. Passion killer number 5. Guilt from unconfessed sin. Guilt from unconfessed sin. You can never be passionate or feel excited when there's guilt. The moment guilt is eating you up, it affects your passion. It affects your enthusiasm. You cannot be, you know, enthusiastic about things when you are guilty at the same time. They just do not mix together. So if there is unconfessed sin, for sure, your passion for the things of God will begin to die. You can feel guilty and passionate at the same time. David says in Psalm 38, verse number 4 and verse number 6, he says, my guilt has overwhelmed me like a burden too heavy to bear. Guilt is a burden, and it is a heavy burden. It actually overbears. In verse 6, he says, I am bowed down and I'm brought low because of the unconfessed sin. Proverbs 28:13, he who covers his sins will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy. You remember the story of the young cook and the older cook? This young cook was employed into the kitchen, and he came in with a lot of excitement for his work. And he was so passionate about work until the day he stole a chicken. And when he stole the chicken and the older cook saw it, and because he did not confess it, it was hidden and confessed. The older cook began to take advantage of the younger cook. They were working in shifts. And the older cook will say, I want you to work my shift today. And the younger one will be like, I mean, how? How do I work your shift? I just finished my shift. And he says, remember the chicken. And every time the man was reminded of the chicken that he stole, that he has never confessed, he will be doing the shift of the senior cook, but he never did it with passion. He was doing it grudgingly until the day he decided enough is enough. I'm going to the boss. And he went, took himself to the boss and said, "Boss, I'm here to confess. I'm sorry. I stole a chicken." And he was forgiven. And the day that he was forgiven after he had confessed his sin, when he went back the next day and the senior cook said, "You work my shift today." And he said, "I am not working your shift." And he said, "Remember the chicken." And he said, "I will not remember the chicken anymore because it is settled." And passion came back to the young cook. Hallelujah. The devil does the same thing with us. He accuses us of things that we have buried and covered. That is why you come to church and the moment you want to lift up your hand, you say, People who do the things you do don't lift up their hands in church. So you put your hand down. And you want to join ministry and I want to join the choir. And the devil says, not you. People who live the way you live don't join the choir. So you coil down. And you feel like a dancing, and the devil says, God does not like pretenders. And you know what? Because of worry, you are pretending, you cool down. But you need to go to the boss, praise the name of the Lord. You need to go to God because the Bible says in 1 John 1:9 that if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of all. Hallelujah. So that when you come back and the devil says, you say, I will worship, hallelujah, praise the name of the Lord. But when it is there eating you up, you can never be passionate at the same time when you're guilty. Number six, passion killer is unresolved conflict. When you have conflict that you have not resolved, hallelujah. Have you seen people, couples who have conflict? They have a conflict at home. Before they left the house, somebody just said, there was exchange of words. But because we are good people, when we come to church, we'll walk together and we will sit next to each other. When you are told, turn to your neighbor, you don't turn to her, you turn to the one behind. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, "Jesus is good and your wife is here," but because of the conflict, you turn to the neighbor behind. Because unresolved conflict has a way of affecting our passion, our excitement and joy. And sometimes you want to worship, but you're thinking, my wife is going to be saying, Sasa. Now you are here trying to lift up your hands, but you don't even remember the way you handled me in the house. There are times I've had issues like that. I mean, I'm coming to church, I'm coming to preach, and there are things that we have not sorted out, and it becomes a struggle for me. Because everybody else is blessed but my wife. Hallelujah, clap your hands, and she's like... And I can feel it. And if I was just about to jump, I go down. If I was just about to say, hallelujah, And I remember something has not been sorted. My passion is killed. It happens to us. So what we need is resolve conflicts, praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Have you ever come to church, you are so excited, until you spot her. And you realize there are things and all of a sudden your joy is just gone. Even the person next to you said, what is the problem? Nothing. But you just saw him. You just saw her. You have conflict and it is unresolved. Now, we need to be careful about this one. Because there are times you have let go, but the other person is still holding on to it. You don't know what to do to resolve this conflict. Just be careful that whatever it is, you don't end up with resentment, you don't end up with jealousy, you don't end up with prolonged anger. Because these things come out of unresolved conflict. And we need to be careful that this thing do not take us in. Job says in Job 5 verse 2, resentment destroys the fool and jealousy kills the simple. Don't allow resentment to destroy you and to kill your passion. You really want to love God, but because of this unresolved conflict, something is pulling you down. Deal with it. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Job 18:4 says, you who tear yourself to pieces in anger, is the earth to be abandoned for your sake? Should we leave the earth for you? That is what Job is saying. You are so angry. Should we leave the earth for you? No. We need each other. All right? So we cannot be too angry, tearing ourselves into pieces. Hebrews 12:14, pursue peace with all people, without which no one will see the Lord. Passion killer number 7, lack of fellowship. When you are not spending enough time around other Christians, you are bound to grow cold. Your passion is bound to die for the things of God. Maybe it will build up on other things, but not. You cannot avoid the fellowship of other believers and expect to still be excited, happy, fiery, passionate for the things of God. Hallelujah. Ecclesiastes 4:9. This is not a verse to preach to the people that are getting married. Two are better than one. It's not about marriage only. It is about us in the house of the Lord. We are better off the way we are than being alone. Hallelujah. You are better off with me. I'm better off with you than being myself. We need fellowship. We need one another. Amen. The Bible says when one goes down or falls, the other one can lift them up. But when you are alone, it becomes difficult. When the enemy corners you, puts you into a corner, he will hammer you properly because you are alone. You won't hear anybody saying, oh, you know, I prayed and I was healed. Oh, you know, I was trusting God for this and this happened. You don't hear that because you are not mingling with the rest of the people. But when you fellowship, then you can be able to hear somebody who prayed, somebody who waited, somebody who trusted, and things worked, but you are just alone. The devil only fills your mind with, yours is not working. It has never worked. Of course, in your family, it has never worked. And even you are worse. It will never work. But you need to hear what other people are also going through. Iron sharpens iron. Praise the name of the Lord. So we need each other. The Bible says in Hebrews 10, 24 and 25, let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds. Love and good deeds are spurred from person to person. When you have no people around you to spur you up, you become cold. Your passion dwindles. And yet God is expecting you to love him with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, with all of your strength. How will it happen when there's nobody sparring you up, when there's nobody motivating you, when there's nobody, you know, injecting some faith into your life? God knows that for you to get there, you need one another. That is why he's telling us, do not forsake the assembling together, brethren. Because we need to spur up one another. That only happens when we fellowship. So lack of fellowship is going to kill your passion. But don't let it. Passion killer number 8, purposelessness or lack of purpose. Life without purpose is activity without direction. And there are times when there's a lot of activity, but there is no direction. Why? Because there's no purpose. And of course, when there's activity without direction, people get to a point where it's like, hey, why are we even doing this? Why are we even jumping up? What is the purpose? What is the reason? It is the purpose that keeps us doing what we ought to do. When the purpose is not there, our passion will die. Life without purpose is motion without meaning. There's no meaning to the motions. Life without purpose is trivial, petty, and pointless. Purpose and passion go together. Hallelujah. When people have a reason to do something, they do it with all of their heart, with their energy. So don't allow purposelessness to kill your passion. Passion killer number 9, spiritual starvation. When you are starving spiritually, your passion will die when you don't have spiritual nourishment. Let me remind us, people of God, that every day we face circumstances, we face challenges, and all these things conspire to kill our passion, our joy, our excitement for the things of God. Distractions of life, disappointments are there. Everywhere we go, we meet with disappointments. We meet with destruction. We meet with conflicts. All these things, they have an effect upon our lives. And we need to get to the point where, you know, we don't allow starvation, spiritual starvation, to kill our passion. Because of the challenges of life, because of all the problems and the issues and the pressures of life, we must feed our spirit. We must nourish our spirit so that we can be able to be strong enough and stand up and remain passionate for God. How do you do that? Number one, you need private times of worship with God. Take time to just fill your life with worship. Number two, you need to fellowship with other believers. You get nourished. Number three, you need to read God's word to make you grow. Number four, you need to have or to be involved in ministry. Do something for God. Hallelujah. If you just choose to do nothing, nobody has ever been passionate for doing nothing. When you're doing something, passion is ignited within you. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. In Revelation chapter 3, God talks about a serious sin, something he doesn't like. And it is not adultery. It is not theft. It is not fornication. God says, I hate this. I don't like it. And you know what it is? Lukewarmness. He says, when you are lukewarm, I will spew out of my mouth. We must be passionate for God, which means we must be careful about these passion killers in our lives. And we are all vulnerable to this. Nobody is too special never to encounter these things that I've mentioned. We all encounter them. It is only by the grace of God if we continue going before the Lord and surrendering and seeking His help that we are able to overcome. Amen. I want us to stand up this morning. I want you to look into your life right now. Just look inside of you. And I want you to ask yourself this question. Deal with this. If you are, there was a time that you are more passionate than you are today. Please know there's a problem. And you need to identify it and deal with it. If there was a time in your life that you loved God more than you love Him today, there's a problem and you need to find it and deal with it. If there was a time that you are more excited to come to church than you are today, there's a problem somewhere and you need to identify it and deal with it. Close your eyes and lift up your hands. This is a sign of surrender to God. You are saying, Lord, I surrender my mind, my emotions, my spirit, my soul to You. I know I'm vulnerable and I need Your help. I need You to help me. Where I have grown cold, may You help me, oh God, to do what it takes, to take the appropriate steps so that I can be able to get back to that excitement mode again. If there's something in me, oh God, either I have allowed my spirit to starve in the things of God, Lord, may you help me to now make a decision to get into the Word, to get to fellowship with others. Whatever it is that has killed my passion, Lord, I pray for yourself right now. You know exactly what it is that has, if there's anything of this thing that I've mentioned, and these are not the only passion killers, there could be many more, and I just want you to ask God to be merciful enough to you and help you to overcome whatever it is that is killing your passion. Whatever it is making you cold. Whatever is making you not be excited the way you ought to be excited. Whatever is making you not to serve the way you ought to serve. Because the truth of the matter is, God loves you so much. Somebody said, God is hopelessly in love with you. He just can't do without you. And that is why when He was on the cross, the cross demonstrates the point that God is saying, I'd rather die if I'm not going to have you or fellowship with you. You need to love Him back. With everything within, you need to love Him back. And you know what? You can never love God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your strength. And the enemy, blocks things your way and blocks your prosperity and blocks your blessings and blocks your miracles. No way. So there are times we run for this miracle or whatever prayers, but then there's a clear way that things can be even better and easier by loving God with all of my heart, with all of my strength, with all of my being. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, this morning we thank You. Lord, we surrender everything to You. Our lives, our minds, Lord, our feelings, we surrender them to You. And we want to pray, oh God, that You may help us not to be lukewarm. Lord, help us to do whatever it takes, that we may pin down what it is that is killing our passion, that we may do something about it, because we want to be revived. We want to be energized. We want to be passionate again. We want to love You again. We want to worship You with everything within us again. So, Father, help us to overcome every passion killer in our lives. In the mighty name of Jesus. You are here this morning, and you are not born again. We don't want you to leave this place without Jesus in your heart. And I want you to just lift up your hand wherever you are. If you are not born again and you are here in this service, or maybe you're backslidden and you're in this service and you want Jesus to restore you back, or you want Jesus to come into your heart, if you lift up your hand, I'll pray with you. Are you there? Can I see your hand? You are not a believer. Father, we thank you today. I want to pray that if there's anybody in our midst that does not know you in a personal way, even as we leave this service, mighty God, I pray that you will minister to us, minister to that person. Draw them to yourself, that they will come to the knowledge of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Let's give the Lord a good hand this morning.
Hema yake na sifa zake.